My name is Leslie Nathan. The date is August 5th, 1997. I'm conducting an interview with Theresa Gericke. The location is London, England. My name is Leslie Nathan. The date is August 5th, 1997. I'm conducting an interview with Theresa Gericke. The location is London, England. Theresa, I understand that we're not going to talk about your life before the war during this interview, so I wonder where you'd like to begin.
Well, I want to begin that why I started this, why I volunteered to give this interview, because I've kept it, it was locked inside me for 50 years, and I suddenly realized that, you know, I am running out of time. I am now 84, and it's for obvious reason, I have to hurry up a bit. And I also realized it, that it's history. And as I am a painter, I maybe see things clearer, more. Maybe I'm more observant than other people. And that's why I would like to give this interview, which is, I have a story to tell, but I don't want to bring myself forward in that story. It is the story, it's not me.
I understand. Well, there are just a few questions I'd like to ask you at the beginning, and then we can start. Can you tell me your name and the spelling?
My name is Theresa Christoph, who was, I was, and I am now Theresa Gericke.
And do you have any other names?
No.
And can you give me the date of your birth?
The 23rd of May, 1913. It's such a high, big number.
And your age now?
84.
And the city and country of your birth?
Hungary. Szeged, which is the second biggest town, nice town.
Thank you. Would you like to start?
Well, where I start, why I... it's not easy to understand it, Auschwitz, which I want to talk about, and in connection with Auschwitz, I wanted to say a few things which probably haven't been told before. It is in Auschwitz everything which you believe that it was impossible in your normal life, it seems in Auschwitz it's become, it's possible. It's, but for an outsider, it's almost difficult to comprehend. It was built, Auschwitz. You wanted to know how I got there.
Well, you said that you were born in Szeged, and that's where you were living when the Germans invaded.
Yes, when it came fairly suddenly, you know, that the people were ushered into a building which was called a ghetto, and then from there.
That was in Szeged.
That was in Szeged, and from there, you know, to what they called. Brick making factory, and then from there on cattle tracks to Auschwitz. I think that arrival being told many times, the journey was horrible, unbelievably horrible. The arrival was horrible, but we were pleased to breathe fresh air after 3 days in incarceration. You couldn't believe it, what is there. That is one thing. That's why people were, I wouldn't say they didn't panic, but I mean they didn't panic as they should because they didn't know what is expecting for them there. So the place is in Auschwitz is built on a plateau which is almost designed to increase human sufferings because the climate is awful. It's very hot during the day. It was cold in the night. And absolutely merciless climate, I would think. And I remember, I tried to pick out little jigsaw pictures, you know, from arriving there, which I can very clearly remember, so clearly I could almost draw them, you know, how. When we were arrived there and marched past a huge pile of clothes, of human belongings, there was a woman SS officer arrived on a bicycle, elegantly picked out one first tall from that pile of clothes and flicked it over the handlebar of her bicycle and drove cheerfully away. And to me, that remained, that picture, the essence of the Nazi cruelty and the suffering. Which it doesn't look very cruel, that picture, that a woman arrived on a bicycle, but the insensitivity, the what was behind, and that a pretty woman would not even comprehend. Didn't show any sense, you know. She was pleased to have his fashionable Marlendicht fur stole. So that was one picture which I remember.
Can you describe this woman in more detail?
I can't. She was a pretty young woman, that's all, in an SS uniform on a bicycle. Nothing I can remember about her. I don't think I ever saw her again. She was one of those people.
And is there anyone else in this picture as she cycled up to this pile of belongings?
No, nothing. It was just the crowd. And I mean, the impression was so many impressions hit you when you arrive there. You can't remember every detail, but that detail I do remember very clearly. Anyway, whatever I'm going to say in that, it is 100% what I believe is the truth, and no more or less. I don't exaggerate.
Theresa, can we go back a little bit? You talked about being in Szeged. Can you describe the circumstances under which you were rounded up, first of all, and taken to the ghetto?
It wasn't rounded up. We just went in, because you had to go in.
So how did you receive the order to go in?
Tell you the truth, I can't remember. I cannot remember. I cannot remember.
Was it from your home or?
It was, no, I was, by that time I lived with a cousin of mine who, and I had my boyfriend coming every day, you know, and I mean it was a very emotional time because we knew that there was something is going to happen, that we had to part, but.
What time of year was this?
44.
And which month, 44. Do you remember?
I'm a bit vague about that as well, you know, I mean, it's probably been recorded many times when the people from Szeged had been taken away. So, I mean, I really don't know.
So if we said summer of 44, would that sound accurate?
Maybe the spring or early summer.
Right.
I mean, just try to remember, you know, that various times what I was doing.
Do you remember who went with you when you were taken?
Yes, I do remember a lot of people who went with me.
Were they friends or relatives?
Only my cousin was my only relative who was there. My parents were in Budapest, not here, and they were not taken away.
And this cousin, she went to the
she
ghetto with you?
She went, I was there with her all the time, yes. She's a very nice woman. Very
Can nice. You tell us anything about her?
Yes. Very warm, very mother of two boys. Who been taken away and killed, the boys, but it was a different story, not the same time, not the same place. And we were very close, and we were together all the time, which was a great help to me and to her.
So the two of you had been together when you knew that the war had started, but when you were still living in your own home?
I lived in her house, in her Yeah.
When you arrived in this area that was designated the ghetto, what did you see?
It was a big block of flat. There were people being crammed into, which never lived before together, you know, in one room, and that was not only inconvenient, it's new, frightening. As I was, by that time, I was baptized, and I was the bishop came to see me and prepared me to die, and we both cried, and she hugged me, and I mean, they were scenes, you know, which difficult to explain.
Did that happen in the ghetto?
Yes.
The bishop coming?
Yes.
So people were coming in and out?
Yes, the bishop was a Protestant bishop. Yes, they could go in and out, not allowed out. And I also can say that the police was not bad. The police was not cruel. It was there was in Hungary a kind of country police called gender, which were cruel to the population, but not the police. Police wasn't.
Can you tell me anything about the baptism?
That was a long time ago, and I prefer not to.
But he knew you as someone who's been baptized. What was his attitude towards you when he came to see you?
Loving. Yes. Yes. Hungary is a different society, as I've told you before.
And how were you identified as Jewish if you had been baptized?
Oh, but that doesn't make any difference if you have Jewish parents.
So they knew that from records? Yeah. And
yes. Yes, I mean, even if you had one Jewish parent, you know, sometimes you've been taken. Yeah.
So you started to describe the ghetto and the block of flats you were in. Can you tell me more about that?
Not really. I can't tell much about that. It is a blur in my head, you know, in my mind. I'm sorry. It's not because I don't want to. I can't. Nothing stands out. I tell you what's stood out in my mind, and I always thought that was such a cruel, horrible thing. And I feel, now there comes the handkerchief. When we were taken away from the brick factory where before Auschwitz, there was our family doctor who was a war hero in the previous war, and he was injured. He couldn't use, but he was the kindest man I know, and he cared for poor, rich, anybody for no money, and he was suffering from cancer. He was quite a young man, and he was suffering from cancer, and they left him lying, dying on the floor. They didn't take him away because he was dying already. And I thought, what a terrible thing for happen to a good man. He was good to everybody. No, and he was injured in the First World War. Anyway,
he was a Jewish doctor.
Always upset me when I think about it.
Was he a Jewish doctor?
Yes, yes.
Did you know him well?
He was our family doctor. Yes, and...
Do you remember his name?
Yes. Dr. X. Yeah. So, I mean, it's a small incident, you know, but I mean, it stood out. I remember that. So that it... Oh, what else would you like to know? Where shall I carry on?
Well, how did you obtain food when you were in the ghetto?
Sorry?
How did you obtain food when you were in the ghetto?
Quite frankly, as I told you, I can't remember. And the ghetto meant... there, you know, because people never lived there in Hungary. There wasn't such a thing. It was just a big building which they called it as such. Mm.
Yeah. When you went there, were you able to let your parents back in Budapest know what had happened to you?
No, it wasn't possible. I don't think so. But they probably knew it. Yeah.
And how did people spend the day in this block of flats?
Were there too long. I can't remember. Maybe it was a week, maybe it was 2 weeks. I can't remember. But that is become more or less insignificant to whatever happened afterwards.
Of course. Can you tell me what you took with you when you went into this block of flats?
I told you that. No, I just... I don't know. I don't know what I should tell because no other reason. Because I come out as the biggest idiot of the whole United Kingdom, and I took a fiola of cyanide, which my boyfriend gave me to take it if I am my life is in danger. It's very full of naivety and stupidity, which I did. I think I'm the only person in the whole world who taken cyanide in Auschwitz. But I don't want to talk more about that because now I'm laughing about it because I don't think there can be anybody more stupid than I am. So please ask me another question.
Well, I wonder what possessions you had with you.
Nothing. Nothing.
While you were there, did anyone try to escape?
It is a good question. Probably they did. Probably they did earlier. I was, to tell you the truth, I was frightened. That was suggested to me, but I was frightened to escape because I thought, if I escape, they surely shoot me. If I'm not escaping, I maybe survive. But I'm sure a lot of people did, but they did earlier. I was supposed to be taken to Switzerland, and something happened that it didn't come off.
Who suggested? You said someone suggested that you might try to escape.
That boyfriend.
I see. Yeah. Is there anything else you can tell me about those times that you spent there?
Not...
People you met, perhaps?
I met a lot of people because, I mean, it's a small town and you know the people. Yes, I do met people, and the people I knew, we kept together later in Auschwitz and later even in Berlin in the slave labor camp. But I think my more interesting story, if you don't mind me saying it, comes later.
Yes, I understand that. I'd just like to get a little bit more of a picture of what was going on in Szeged before you left. Was there any contact with the local Hungarian population once you were in the block of flats?
Little. They came to the door. But they couldn't get in. But sometimes the policemen outside the door let people in. When you look at it, you know, it was a terrible thing, you know, that people, that was hardly guarded. It was a few policemen, and that was all. That door is there. It was hardly guarded, but the people were like lamb going to the slaughterhouse, a little bit like that.
You talked about the bishop coming. Did anyone else manage to get through to see you?
No. Yes, my... This man came, you know, my boyfriend came to the door and we say goodbye in a flood of tears.
That must have been very painful.
Yes, it was. It was, but I felt, you know, I must have been very immature to not to see what I could see now, you know, my complete stupidity. But, I mean, young people are, and I was young at the time.
You talked also about a brick factory. Can you tell me more about that?
It's just like any brick factory, hopeless and crowded in. You know, I mean, that was the first introduction to cruelty. What can happen? That was the brick factory. An introduction to human cruelty, which we thought that was the end. And then we realized that it's nothing, what is coming.
So what did you see there?
They're just lying on the floor in a vet, crammed together with people, no belongings, no food, nothing. So, I mean, it left my mind, you know, that what happened there.
So what was your connection with the brick factory?
Nothing. That was a sorting place for Auschwitz, for the train.
So when did you go there? After you'd been in Szeged ghetto?
No, after the brick factory.
That's what I mean. You went to the brick factory after Szeged. The brick factory was where?
No, in Szeged, outside the town.
How far outside?
I don't know. Not far, probably not.
And how long were you there at the brick factory?
I can't tell you. Leslie, I would like, but I can't. The impressions are so crowded, you know, that it's not important to, because there was nothing happened there. We're just waiting to be, have something, to be rescued, to be taken, I don't know what we were waiting.
I wonder what you were talking about amongst yourselves as to what you thought would happen next.
I don't even remember. Nobody, you know, it's not a thing which you can imagine. It never happened before. How could you put a, explain it?
Well, that's why your impressions are so important, because you can give us your picture of how it was.
I mean, I even can tell you when I don't know, and that's what I'm saying now.
You talked about being in one room with your cousin. Were there any other people in the room?
I mean, the bread factory has no rooms. You
no,
know,
before yeah. that in...
Yes. Most of the time we were kept together.
With other people in one room? Or?
I think so. Oh, yes. A lot of people. I can't remember. It was a crowd. It was not... They were not my friends, you know. They were just thrown together.
So once you got to the brick factory, what happened then?
We were waiting. Something should happen. I mean, that's what I told you.
And how were you chosen to leave there?
Everybody was taken out from there. It wasn't selection there.
So was that a mixture of men and women and?
Everybody, yes, a mixture.
Any children?
Oh, yes. And on the cattle train, and then to a station. I don't know where was the station or where was the... I really have no recollection of that part.
Do you remember who organized to get you people on the cattle trucks?
I would like to remember sometimes. I can't. I really would like to, but I cannot remember. A face, a uniform, nothing. Nothing. I remember the journey, which was a terribly nightmare. When they closed the doors, and I survived that because I was underneath the window, that grill.
Did people die on the journey?
I can't remember even. I heard that a lot of people died. And I know that, but I cannot remember. I know that I was, my most important thing was not even food, but air in that place. And I could breathe air, you know, somehow. And I don't know when I'm right, but somebody told me once that in emergency, I start thinking clear. And I think it rescued me many times, you know, that, and so.
Can you describe the sanitary conditions?
None.
On the truck?
None. That is the worst part of it, of course. But let me talk about my own thoughts because I think what I have many 50 years to think about. I have quite a lot of time. The biggest cruelty, you know, which every nation practiced probably in the when they had war or tried to suppress another nation, to humiliate people and to take away their dignity. And it's terribly easily done. If the Germans put in 50, I don't know how many people, in one cattle track, and they don't give them food, don't give them sanitation, they become smelly, dirty animals. But it can happen to them very easily. Every is not have to be a special age or race. I witnessed something which I also can remember. After I was liberated in Germany, in Mecklenburg, and I remember being in a school, and suddenly I saw German beings. Russian soldiers were haunting, not haunting, what is it, chasing in, what is the word for it, Germans, prisoners.
Yes, hoarding them.
Hoarding them, that's the word I'm looking for. And it was, I was looking down in the first floor window from a school, and there was a church opposite. And one of the German soldiers sat down on the stairs, and obviously the poor chap has diarrhea. And he done it in front of the church, steps of the church. And the Russian soldier started saying, "You pig, you know," and it was, "How could you do that?" Easy, it's easy. There is no such a master race who is deprived from every, the way they used to live, and hygiene and food and sleep, that they could behave in a dignified way. They all behave the same way. But the Germans used that against the Jews. But they could fall into that just as easy. That's all I wanted to say. And that picture is with me. I was sorry for that soldier, but I could see it, how that could happen.
Can we go back to the journey?
Yes.
Did you have any idea of where you were going?
No. But there was some suggestion. I was together with a lot of people who were non-Jewish and very liberal-minded. And they were talking about that they heard something, that there will be a tunnel where the train will go and they will be gassed. So there was, the guessing was in the air, you know, the news
where
about it.
Where did you hear that?
Before I left even at all. Mm-hmm. And so that was, of course, not true, but it was part of it, too. So there was, rumors were circulating.
How long was the journey?
Maybe 3 days, maybe five, I don't know. I just don't know.
This is take two. I'm conducting an interview with Theresa Gericke. The location is London, England. You were talking about the journey, about 3 days, Theresa. Can you?
3 or 5, I don't know. But I don't want to give a wrong impression in case it is. I'm not correct.
Can you tell us about the arrival?
The arrival, it was a relief when they opened the train door. Obviously, if somebody was without air, food, sanitation, you know. You don't mind if it is hell, and it was hell. That they did not know. We did not know. That was very carefully done. The young people, as we all know it, the young people went one way, and the healthy one, and the grandmothers, mothers with babies and children, the other way. You thought that there was just separation. You did not realize that is, they're going marching into the gas chamber. You didn't do.
What was the first thing you saw when they opened the doors?
A lot of German officers, German soldiers, dogs, and some people with striped uniforms. The stripe were there for a longer time, I think, because I never had stripe in Auschwitz. they ran out, I suppose, of the clothes.
Do you remember the first things that were said to you?
Probably the famous Rouse. Yeah. No, I can't remember.
And how?
No, I can't remember. We just, you try to keep together with the people whom you know, and you, they just, probably they told us to march straight on, which we did.
What did you think was happening?
No, I don't know. Quite frankly, I don't know. I tell you, I would probably jump in events. The first time I realized, I mean, first of all, the horror to be taken to a shower room where you've been shaved and you didn't recognize each other, you know, you don't recognize yourself or your best friend, you know, being completely shaven. And that was done not by the Germans but by these Slovak girls who've been what I call it the veterans of Auschwitz, who've been there for many years.
How did you know they were Slovak?
We know it. They suffered a lot. They've been toughened up a lot. Sometimes they were nice, sometimes they were not nice, and that's how they survived.
So you talked about getting off the train and being sent one direction. Can you tell me more about that?
Well, we went to a big compound, you know, which, as I described, that pile of clothes which that German woman picked out of her store. And I saw some frightened-looking prisoners who been frightened out of their mind, with whispering to us as we passed, you know, where you come from, because they were looking for relations, I suppose. I mean, it was still not very clear what is happening to us, not at all clear.
You said they whispered to you. Which language did they use?
Probably Hungarian, probably.
Did anyone ask you your age at this stage?
No. No, nobody asked the age.
What happened next?
What happened? I don't remember, but we must have been marched into a block. And there was a, that's where I first realized that there is a oven, there is a gas chamber, because that Blokova, which is the leader of the who ran the camp, was quite a nice woman. We were lucky, she was not. And she said, "You crazy, you mad, don't you realize that that is what you smell is people burned?" And some people just thought she telling stories.
What did you think?
Well, I mean, sooner or later you realize, you know, I mean, what it was.
Were you still with your cousin?
Yes, all the time.
What was her name?
Elizabeth.
And you talked about the block over. What nationality was she?
I think she was Slovak. But it was quite a nice woman. And that is in my, which I would like to talk about, is, you know, which is, I drifted into talking about me, but I really want to talk about, you know, the things I was doing in various camps, and because that was unusual, that's why. All the other stories which I told, it was told before, I'm sure.
Well, each story is unique.
I think I am sure about that.
So you arrived in this block. Do you know which camp you were in?
No idea. No, you don't move much away from it. And I would like to talk about the gypsies.
Please tell us.
Mm-hmm. One day we had to... They'd taken us often, not often, but sometimes, to have shower. Now, that shower, you had to run on a very nasty, not pavement, it was rocks, on rocks. It was all designed to suffering, I would think. And as we were march past that fenced area. There were people camping out there, crowd of people, men, women, and children. And they were normal clothes, but they were camping outside. We were in a block, which is an empty room when you talk about block. And they were outside. And we realized that they were gypsies. But
how
which nationality, I don't know. They were very near. I was running here and he was there. Whether we talk, whether anybody said, I don't know. But it was not something which you can guess. It was. And one night, probably soon after that, what I have seen, I can't remember the timing, in the night I woke up, screams, people calling each other desperately, names, and the dogs, the guard dogs were barking like hell. And the next morning, the Blokova, who was well informed, he knew the sounds in that place, he said, you know, the gypsies were gassed in the night, taken to the gas chamber. So that's how I know. And a few days later, when we passed again to the shower, there was empty. The place was empty, only bits of belongings to the human belongings, you know, and clothes. Or maybe I think even kitchen utensils. I mean, things which they carried with them. And that was what the gypsies left behind. You have to get the atmosphere right. Auschwitz is very quiet in the night. Only the dogs barking. Not furiously, but dogs barking here and there. That night they were furiously barking. And very cold in the night. There was a suspicion, I only say suspicion because I cannot prove it, that the food was just like cutting the grass and boil it. And that's what you've been eating. That was the food, plus a piece of bread and a tiny margarine. That was your daily ration. But people believed that they must have putting bromide in it to calm the prisoners, which I inclined to believe it. It was very bitter. But I inclined to believe it because whether it was, the people were very docile, and it's very much easier to handle people who are not violent or hysterical or panicky. And I remember that I was young and healthy, but I remember during the day I was just nodding off, sitting in that faint sunshine or hot sunshine, because in the middle of the day it was very hot. You nodded off.
Talking of bromide reminds me that you...
I don't know whether it is true, because I haven't tasted it, but that was the rumour.
It reminds me that you told me earlier that you took a cyanide capsule with you. What happened to it?
I told you I don't want to talk about that because that would make me look the stupidest woman on earth. All I can say for everybody's comfort that I buried it in the ground. And when I left, I took it out and smashed it on a rock. So that nobody should pick it up. Otherwise, people would think it's salt or something. And it went to hundreds of pieces.
It's amazing you could think of that at a time.
I could think about it as the biggest, stupidest step I had done in all my life.
Well, no, I meant to protect others. To think
yes,
that
was a very good... I think that was, because that's why I'd done it, that nobody should pick it up. Mm. Yes, I think it was clear. It was still clear in my head.
Going back to the gypsies, can you remember how many there were in this compound?
No. No, but it could be 100, could be 200. I don't know. There were so many things to be occupied. First of all, where you put your feet, because it was that very sharp rocks you had to run, and I don't know whether I had our shoes or not. I can't remember.
Can you describe the block that you were in and who else was there?
A lot of people from my hometown, some, and it's just a lot of people.
Any, I mean, were they all Hungarians or other nationalities?
No, there were no other nationalities. They were all one group. In fact, more or less, almost similar area. I don't know, really, but I know there were no other nationalities.
And your sleeping arrangements, can you describe that?
Have you opened a sardine tin?
Yes.
Well, that's the sleeping arrangement.
What clothes did you have? You talked about not wearing striped uniform. What were you wearing?
Anything which is thrown at you. I think I had a very flimsy silk dress, which the people left behind and they throw at you. It was a terrible, cold and horrible.
Did you have anything else apart from the dress?
I can't remember. I don't think so. The striped uniform we got when we left Auschwitz to go to, eventually to Berlin.
Mm. Could you describe an average day there?
There, just sitting on the floor, talking, even joking, I think, to people whom we know, we're friends.
What would you talk about?
I can't remember.
The jokes? Do you remember what you found to laugh about?
I don't remember, but I mean, I was very fated at the time when I was drawing that German soldier, which I want to come back on.
Would you like to, I mean...
Yeah, one...
It's important that we know that you are an artist.
They knew, must have known that I was an artist, and somebody must have told that woman, that Vlogova, that Slovak woman. And one day, unexpectedly, he said, would you do a drawing of a German soldier? And I went there. He was talking to the soldier in a friendly way, and he gave me paper. Pencil and paper, and I started drawing him. And we never in that tiny little room which he had. So there was, we never exchanged one single word. He never talked to me, not because he was frightened. He was frightened of me, because he probably was a marked man himself. I learned it from that woman. That he was there because he was punished in Auschwitz. That's the first time I realized that the people were sent there as punishment.
You mean the soldiers?
Soldier. He wasn't an SS. He was a soldier. And what he was doing, I don't know.
What rank was he, do you know?
Sorry?
Do you know what rank he was?
Not very high. I don't know.
I mean, was he an officer or a
I don't think he was
a soldier.
I think he was a soldier. And it seems to me that he was a frightened man, terribly frightened man.
How and he did didn't you like pick up that feeling that he was frightened?
That was easy. I mean, sitting, not a word talking, not a word spoken. And I was busy doing it, hand it over.
What did
and
you
I got
feel?
A piece of bread.
You got a piece of bread for doing it?
Mm-hmm.
What did you feel
very
as
glad.
You sat there?
And my friends thought that was fantastic.
Yes. How long did it take you to do it?
I don't know, half an hour, an hour, something like that. It was a sketch. Probably it was quite a good one.
Can you describe the man?
No, he was a youngish man. Not very young, but sort of 28, 29.
Do you remember anything about his face?
No. There was nothing stand out. Except what I kept with me is the atmosphere which was in that room. That was quite something. That time I didn't know, but I will tell that later.
You
know?
Say that he felt fear, that fear. You were aware
fear
of
fear came through. It was positive, that fear. Fear, I mean, can you picture two people sitting silently in a tiny room and surround you all the horrors of Auschwitz. And he knew it, he saw it, I saw only part of it. I was the participant, I was the sufferer, but he maybe had to participate.
I wonder, why would he take such a risk?
I don't know. That is a good question. I don't know why he taken that risk. And why he taken the risk to talk friendly to this woman. It wasn't a customary thing.
And how did she know that you were an artist?
I don't know he knew, but she knew. She probably knew from my friends. Maybe I did some drawing before, probably. But how had I paper? Because I couldn't have any paper or pencil.
Sitting there drawing this man, how did that compare with past experiences as an artist in freedom, from an artistic point of view?
That doesn't come into it. When you face somebody whom you want to do, that is only one aim in mind, is to do it well. He wanted, obviously, likeness, which he obviously wanted. And I wanted to excel, you know, to be very, very good, obviously.
Had you painted many portraits before?
Not too many, but I drawn some.
So was that a specialist area for you before the war?
No, my drawing people was always, which I always done, is where my strengths lie. And I was glad I could use it, because it was really survival for me. Extra food is survival in a place like that.
How long do you think you were in the room with him?
I don't know, about a half an hour, an hour, something like that. And no, really, I don't remember this one.
When you'd finished, what did you do with the drawing?
I gave it to him, or the block of eye, I can't remember.
Was she there throughout?
No, she was not there at all. Or during the time she left the room, he came back. And he supplied me with the extra bread.
So he gave you the bread?
She gave me the bread. Oh. She gave me, the woman gave me the bread. But authorized by him. No, he was a nice man.
What happened when you gave him the drawing? Did he acknowledge it in any way?
I was invisible in a funny way. Almost. No. No, I can't remember that. In fact, I would remember if it was acknowledged. I don't think it was. But not in a hurtful way.
I wonder what you thought when you went back to your block.
Oh, they were probably asking a lot of questions, and they were very pleased for me.
So you felt it safe to tell the other prisoners?
Why shouldn't I? There was nothing.
Well, because the man was afraid.
Man was afraid of me. The situation he let himself into. But I had nothing to be afraid of him or anybody else, you know. I was afraid of Mengele, which I would like to talk about.
Please do.
I saw him nearly every day, because he came with an entourage of people, officers, women officers, laughing their head off, having wonderful jokes. And one day there was a super, but they were another selection. Selection day. It was in a big, like a football ground, this huge ground, and there were hundreds and hundreds of starved, shaven, naked women parading in front of him. And he was pushing it one this way and pushing that way. And then, as I told you before, you know, I started running in the direction where my friends were. I was very thin that time. And only I remember it was like Dante's Inferno, an illustration from that. And I could always remember that how the Germans or the Nazis was believed that they could win a war by parading naked starved women, does it help them? Did they, how they felt about that? How they could do it? I still don't understand it. I still can't. That how their brain was twisted, that they could accept a picture like that, and they accepted that they are the cause for it. It was never, it will never enter my mind how they could do it. But, and I felt, you know, there, you know, also I am, have a, my own religion, that there must be above some a power which could never let it happen, never approve of that, you know. It happened, I know it happened, but that could not lead to anything which is victory. I mean, that one thing should stop it. But I mean, that is again simplistic and naive, maybe.
You talked about this selection. What happened to you after that? You got onto the other side.
Yes, I mean, I went back again to the block and went on, I don't know how long, I can't remember, until they were marched a few weeks, a few months later.
A few months, you think, perhaps?
Maybe it was a few months, maybe it was a few, I can't, you know, time is very, can be very confusing when you think back.
Were there any other drawings while you were in Auschwitz?
I did one. Probably I did more. I can't remember. But that one I remember.
Because it was the first, or?
That was the first one. Yeah. So when we...
Can you tell us about any of the others?
I remember once, but I really don't want to talk about it. I don't want to talk
it's
about it.
It's such a unique role that you had there. If you could just tell us...
I haven't got a unique role. Time to time, they will... Somebody said, just do a drawing of this or that. And they had to provide me with pencil and paper because I haven't got anything.
Is that all you were ever given, pencils and paper?
Yes.
Any other medium?
No.
And were they Germans or other people?
There was once a woman who wasn't a German. She was a Slovak.
Can you describe that?
I think I described that once to you, but I don't want to talk about it because I felt it was a situation only interesting for me. I don't think it could be interesting for anybody else. I would like to talk, you know, to have time to talk about the story in Berlin.
Well, you said you were some months in Auschwitz. How was it decided that you should leave? Can you...
2 months, 3 months, something like that, altogether. But really, I'm not... Time, you know, you can cross-examine me on timing. I cannot tell.
Well, perhaps the weather would be an indication. It was hot, you described earlier.
Yes,
when you
I thought that it could be, but that is during the day.
Yeah.
Yes, the weather was... That's why I thought it could have been early spring when we got there, or early summer.
And what was the weather like when you were preparing to leave?
I think it was still summer. I think it was summer. I was thinking often, you know, how interesting that this sort of thing just leave your mind. And can't remember.
So what happened?
Well, to our surprise, we expected that we were taken away, but you never know. Because in a place like that, everything was sprung on you, you know. I mean, if they have no maybe, you know, you can end up in a gas chamber very easily. Also end up in, as we did, luckily, in Berlin. The reason why I survived, I think, because we were entered the war late. And Germany and England entered the war late. And by that time, they needed everybody who was able-bodied in the front, so they could make use of the prisoners. And if that wouldn't be the case, we wouldn't be alive. So that's why they were taking us on slave labor.
How did they choose you for this slave labor?
Well, the whole block went. The whole block went.
And how many was in the block?
No, it was a whole train full of people. Maybe there were more blocks than that. There were.
What sort of train was it this time?
It's a cattle train.
Were you packed in the same way?
Not so much, not so much. And this time there was organized food. There was one young German couple who looked after us, who were very sweet. They were in love and they were sitting on the, dangling their feet down on the side of the train, and they were happy that we left them alone.
When you say a couple, were they?
A woman and a man and a woman.
Soldiers?
Whether it was SS or not, I don't know. They were looking after us.
How did they behave towards you?
Well, it's all right. They were fine. They were fine.
And you say you had food?
They were rations, some kind of rations, yes.
What did you have?
The bombardment went on already in Burma. I saw the most beautiful bombardments on the from the train. And we didn't know where we were going. We were thinking of the Red Cross going to evacuate us, all kind of things. And then we arrived in eventually in Ravensbrück, from Ravensbrück.
On this train?
On this train. There were millions of different nationalities.
What were your first impressions of Ravensbrück?
Very interesting, because of the many nationalities. And there were in many nationalities, many religions, many classes. But there were lots of nice pictures I can remember from Ravensbrück, that the people didn't know who we were who came in. And there was once a Polish woman came in, and I asked from the to the window, and I asked why you are here, and she said it was in Warsaw. She was Catholic, and she said, you know, I gave bread to a Jew, and then they took me in, but I will do it again. And there was a woman, an opera singer from Prague, who was also interned there, or whatever they call it, and he came to the window and was singing, beautiful. She was probably a top singer, big woman, nice woman. She was singing operas. And
do you remember her name?
No.
We can stop there. This is tape 3. I'm conducting an interview with Theresa Gericke. The location is London, England. Theresa, you were talking about your arrival in Ravensbrück. Can you tell me more about that?
What I said before, you know, it was an interesting place. A lot of nationalities, a lot of languages spoken. When you read later about these places, you realize that you only know a little part of it, what was there, but there were a lot of things going on there which you have no idea. Ravensbrück wasn't such a friendly place as it appeared. Later on, I realized. But I mean, when you are there, you just see one thing. You can. I remember once I went to a French doctor, young man, and because I was bitten by fleas that I was absolutely covered, and he just joked, cracked a sarcastic joke, and dismissed me. Now,
what was the joke? Do you remember?
Yes, catch them and kill them. Something like that, not very witty. But it was what was so impressive for me, for us, that these people have hair. They look human.
How did they respond?
A woman doesn't look
it.
Human without the hair, I tell you. I mean, maybe that is fashion just nowadays, but it is. And they looked us in bewilderment, you know, that what happened to you? Have you done something wrong? Because they not realize it, that sort of thing exists. In fact, the Germans were so good of concealing the Nazis, you know, that what happened in one place to not keeping from the other, that they have no idea what happening. I mean, they were prisoners who didn't know why the other prisoners look like and where they come from. That there is such a thing as Auschwitz.
Did you tell them about Auschwitz?
Probably we did. Probably we did. I don't know. I talked to them. I was managed to talk to them. But you assemble your information later. It is all very fragmented.
How did the conditions at Ravensbrück compare with those that you'd left at Auschwitz?
It's just completely different. That is, you can see that there is somewhere civilization in the world. In Auschwitz, there isn't. It is just a place to be people to be tortured.
So what made it more civilized?
The people walking around, talking around, having their own clothes. They were not in uniform.
What did you have to wear when you got there?
There was the stripy one. But that was an improvement on my condition, that I had something which is. And that's how we arrived to Berlin.
So how long were you at Ravensbrück?
Only maybe 2 or 3 days, maybe 3 days, not more.
You talked about conversing with other nationalities in Ravensbrück. Which nationalities did you talk to and in which language?
German, Hungarian, French.
Did you speak German?
I speak German a bit.
And yeah. French?
A little. Mm. No, that was, everybody tried to communicate. It wasn't that, you know, you desperately. They were interested, who are these rather starving-looking newcomers here? What they doing here? I mean, they were there for years in that camp. So they were also cut off from news, probably had more news than we had. We had none.
Was the food any different there?
No. Or they were not giving any more. I can't remember that soup which made of cut grass or whatever it is.
And
no, that wasn't.
What were the
I don't think
conditions
it was.
There?
I can't remember. I really can't.
Were you still with your cousin?
Yes, always.
Mm-hmm. When you were at Ravensbrück, did you see anything beyond the camp?
No, nothing.
Any of the local population?
No. You just couldn't wander around the place. I mean, in that little area, but not otherwise. No, I don't give. I have no idea.
You said you spoke to the French doctor.
They were also, I told you, I think, they were also lesbians there.
How did you know?
Because they told me. French, pretty girl, I remember one. Because I didn't know what that pretty girl doing here. And they was told me that was.
Are you saying that's why she was there?
I was wondering why she was there in Ravensbrück, which nice, beautiful hair and everything. That's what it was. But I mean, it was part of the whole thing, you know, that was absurd from beginning to an end.
And who were the guards at Ravensbrück?
Probably the same, similar. I know the German guards, you know, but it was SS or not, probably SS.
But not the Slovaks that you had at...
No, the Slovaks were not guards. Mm. Slovaks were...
In the blocks?
The blocks, supervising the blocks. They are the one who stayed there. They didn't come with us. I don't think so.
So who was in charge of your block in Ravensbrück?
Probably a soldier. I don't know. I only remember the fleas.
Well, how was it arranged that you left there?
Back again on a train into Berlin. By that time, I think we were told that we are going to go to Berlin. And working in a factory. But that came bit by bit, and I can't remember how big it was. Who told me when, where.
Can you tell me about the journey?
The journey was... we realized, you know, the bombing, because in Auschwitz, we haven't get much, there was not much bombing. But there, as we were getting nearer to Berlin, the bombing was tremendous. Beautiful, because it is lit up the sky like a lot of balloons. I mean, it's fantastic. And there we were taken to a camp, which was told that it was before Russian prisoner of war lived there before. And then, whether it was the day after or 2 days later, I can't tell you, but we were taken to a factory, which the name is Argus. It was an aeroplane engine factory. I worked on I was allocated a very difficult machine, which was doing shaving off the raw material from a block of metal. It was terribly heavy, and arrived from the foundry, straight from the foundry. And it was spiraling around, and it was cooled by skirted water over it. So it was, can you picture me? I was like fencing 8 hours a day, because you have a stick in your hand, and you have to, the spirals which shoot out from the engine as it goes around, I have to push it away from my face, away from everywhere. And then when it was done, then I put it down, and then it went to another machine. And actually, one reason why I volunteered, one reason, because I wanted to tell aboard that the ordinary Berliners were not Nazis, and I'm convinced about that. They hated the Nazis. Hitler hated them.
You say you volunteered, Theresa?
I volunteered for your interview. That's what I meant, volunteer.
Can you tell me, do you know what part you were making for these Argus aircraft?
Engine, aeroplane engines. Mm. And we have... one or two machines had the same foreman. And I had a wonderful man who was a Berliner, who was in his civilian life. He was a mill, working in a flour mill. And he was the kindest man I know. There were some other kind people. But he was, to my mind, the nicest one. They were also in the factory, a lot of workers from all over the world, which were living outside Berlin. They were Czechs, Dutch.
Were they Jewish?
No, but they lived outside.
So was it only the Hungarian group that was Jewish?
Yes, and been there because they were. No, they were, well, they had been good. they had access to communication much more than we, and they supplied us with the news of what is the situation in the world. So one day I turned to this foreman whose name was Otto Faupel, which I repeated so long that I should never forget him, that what I'm worried, you know, that my engine can help the German war effort. And he said, don't worry, my dear. He said, this plane will never go up because we have no raw material, we have no petrol or fuel, we have no pilots, we have no experts, we have no spare parts, so just relax, it will never go up again. So I was wondering about that often, you know, that this simple worker knew that the war is over and finished to carry on a hopeless war. And Hitler and his henchmen not realized it? Or were they so selfish and power thirsty that they sacrificed their own people, I'm not talking about prisoners, their own people for their own power? That's what conclusion I come to. That's what they were doing. It was over. But it was like, the factory was like a charade. When we knew that there was a man come from the ministry or whatever, official, then all the machines started working, all the lights were on, everybody was busy rushing backwards and forwards. But it was a stage. It was like on a stage set.
So what was happening to the engines once they were assembled? Were they going off to be fitted with the rest of the aircraft?
Well, there were a lot of things that had to go on before that. I got the roughest part. It comes from the foundry. That's why it's so heavy. And that's why my back is... That the machine says thank you to my back. That's when it happened.
You still suffer from that?
I had two big operations, yes. And I knew that that's what it was. I often said, you know, you try to move, I can tell you, show you the movement I was doing it. Bending down, pushing it up, putting it down again. Now, that movement, if you try to do that 100 times a day, it's heavy, very heavy.
How heavy do you think it was?
I don't know. I haven't got a chance to make. So, but which I wanted to talk about this man whose wife sent me, about Otto Faupel, who my wife sent me cakes to the, not only to me, but others too, to the factory.
Did you meet her, his wife?
No, you couldn't. That was impossible.
Where were you living?
It was just a man in the factory.
While you were working in this factory, where were you living?
In the camp, which was, I told you.
Had been for prisoners?
Which was, yes.
What were the conditions there?
Little food, a lot of work. And I was painting my portraits, drawing my portraits there. That's what was the way I helped my life.
Can I just, were the sleeping arrangements?
They were bunks. They were not sardines anymore. And I also remember that the manager or director of the FAV, Argus, was probably a decent man, because when the camp there was discipline, you know, I mean, if you stole a potato or something, you know, you've been even whipped. And the biggest punishment was always to shave your head off again. Hair off again. And when a few prisoners came in the factory with shaven head, that man saw it and demanded the SS. Why? And it should never happen again. And there was a big shouting match between the two. So I know that they were not friends.
This is the owner?
Owner or director, God knows what. Yeah, I don't know. But he was an intelligent looking man who sometimes in a white coat rushed through. I never talked to him. But he was known as a decent fellow.
How close to the center of Berlin was the factory and the
I have no idea.
Camp?
I wish I would know. Berlin Schönholz.
Schönholz.
Have a look at it. Maybe we'll find out.
Did you see any of the local population when you were there?
Yes. They looked us down from a ramp, high ramp, in bewilderment. They didn't know who we are. And once a German woman ran after our column, crying, wanted to give a pair of shoes to prisoners who had rags on their feet. And he was chased away by the SS, the soldier. But he obviously, you know, I mean, people are individuals, good and bad. And he maybe had a son out in the front and wanted to somehow be nice to somebody.
Was that the only contact you ever had with the outside world then?
No, the other four men in the factory too. We could talk to them.
What sort of things would you talk about?
I don't know. I mean, we couldn't ask, you know, what's the war like? Because I knew when Hitler was, funny enough, I heard something that there was an assassination attempt against Hitler. I knew there was something happening. I don't know how the story came, but we knew it, that there was something.
Can you tell me the hours that you worked in the factory?
There were two shifts. One shift was for in the night shift and the day shift. I don't know. I'm not feeling a bit well.
And was your cousin Elizabeth with you?
Yes.
Working?
Yes, but the reason why I painted, I was drawing many of the SS women came to me after, when we came back from the factory afterward, is to draw a picture of them, of their portraits. And they were, I wouldn't say queuing up, but almost. But the reason was very understandable, that in Germany, they was not allowed to use, or they couldn't use, filming or photographic material, because that was all kept for the war effort. If somebody wanted to send a photograph of themselves or of themselves from their son or husband, then they couldn't have a snapshot. So they asked me to do a drawing, and that's what they sent. That's why I did it. Or they send it back to their parents in the country. I don't know, but that was the reason that I was in demand.
So can you tell us how it began, how you were first heard of?
I don't know, really, whether I was doing drawing there or not. I don't know. But but whether it was before or after that, I did also big cartoons for the guard who in by the door or by the entrance where there was some celebration in the camp, and they asked me to do some big cartoons. And that was a bit of a dangerous project for me, because I have to make them look ridiculous, but not too much.
How did you manage?
I am not very good at cartoons at all, but I did.
What was their response to what you did?
Oh, they liked it, and I managed to be very diplomatic about it, you know.
Difficult.
It's difficult. Two I remember, the rest I don't remember. Two I remember.
What was the very first one? I mean, how did it first come to the notice of the people in...
I don't know, I must have been drawing there. I must have been, because it was...
Did you have materials there?
They gave me materials. Mm-hmm. I even did a drawing from a photograph of the Unterscharführer's mother, which was from a photograph, because she was obviously not there. And I remember his attitude, where he behaved in the camp. And when I went into his living quarters and he looked for a photograph, he was almost a gentleman.
Do you remember his name?
No. No, he wasn't an extremely nice man, but he wasn't a nasty man either.
So you say he was the Unterscharführer of the camp that you were staying in while you worked at the Argos factory.
Yeah. And the woman whom I did, because mostly women wanted to have their portrait, it was very nice for me. I got a piece of bread, but it was in the meantime, I slept much less than the others, because when everybody came back they went to sleep and I was sitting there and drawing them.
So this was in addition to your shift at the factory?
Yes, yes. But it was a blessing. It was a blessing.
Are there any other specific people you remember, as well as this man's mother?
Yeah, well, that only lately I remember that I did one. I can't remember how it looked like. No, just the various women whom I did. I must have been quite good at it or quick at it, because, I mean, it was not more than an hour that they set for me.
Where did you sit to do
in the arc block.
In your block?
In our block. I didn't go anywhere.
What would people say to you when you gave them what you'd produced for them? A piece of art?
I don't know. I don't know. Things have different... They looked things different. Everything was so different. I don't know. I really don't know. I know I've done those. I know I give it to them. I know I find out why later. Because of the... I think I mentioned to you in the once that in the factory I did a Dutch worker came to me who lived outside the camp, and he asked me what I would do from a photograph a soldier who died. Now, he got friendly outside in Berlin with his parents. He was a boy who was working as a freiwillige Arbeiter, they call these workers. And so he brought the photograph, and I was thinking, you know, for days, you know, what I'm going to ask for it. And I thought I'd ask a piece of bread, and I know I will ask an apple. No. Then I decided that I will ask a toothbrush. And I did the drawing, and I gave it to him, and he didn't come in for a few days. And then when he came in, I said, have you got my toothbrush? And he said, I'm sorry. But when I went to look for it, the parents, I couldn't find a house because the RAF bombed it. There was no house anymore. So that remained in our family. That's how the RAF bombed my toothbrush. I haven't got a toothbrush. I mean, I remember little incidents with certain humor. Yeah.
You talked earlier of your impression of the Berliners as not being so Nazi. Can you?
No, I would describe them as social democrats.
How did you reach that decision?
Decision because I talked to the others.
Which others?
The other four men. Mm-hmm. Not as intimately as to this one, but to talk to the others. And they were. And that was what the ordinary Berliner was. My brother was educated in Berlin. And that's how I knew a little bit what a Berliner are like.
Had you been to Berlin before?
No, never.
So your
never.
Brother...
I'd never been outside since and before, no.
But what impression had your brother given you?
That is, that, you know, the ordinary people in Berlin, they were so socialistic. But not Nazi, definitely not. And if you read any story about Hitler, Hitler loaded the Berliners because they were not much more.
How long was your brother there?
Well, he was there much before the war. 4 years, I think he was at the university in Charlottenburg.
What did he do there?
Engineer.
And where did he go after that?
Hungary. I mean, he was...
So what happened to him during the war?
He was, he escaped. He was all right. He was all right.
He got out of Hungary, you mean? Or?
No, he didn't get out of Hungary, but he was, there was a story that he jumped off a train and then found his way through back to his home. It is a complicated story. I can't be in such a details. He died a few years ago.
So going back to Berlin, can you tell me more about the people that you met as a result of your drawings?
Not anymore what I said in Berlin. No. What I said, I'm not. My drawing memory is going back to when I was after liberation, when we're after the death march in Mecklenburg, found the Germans ran away, the Russians came in, and that was the point when I, funny enough, in that very point when the Russians came in and the Germans and that I did my very nice drawings. It was in a small room, and there was a Mongolian, a Mongolian officer, high ranking, very tall, like a giant. And his tiny little fellow, which was his, what they call it, Batman. His Batman. And I think, you know, my cousin was very naughty about this. He kept on saying, you draw, you know. So they set down all the medals, and I started drawing him. And then I drew the little man too, the little Batman too. And they were very pleased. They laughed, and they were very naive and very sweet. They said, oh, you know, and they thought it was hilarious. Yeah. But that was, thinking back, it's a strange moment to choose, because it was the day the war ended almost. That must have been. I started off saying that, you know, I can talk in, fill in jigsaw puzzles, but it's only in a jigsaw puzzle which I can remember things. The way I find out that end of the war, I was on a lorry, and a peasant woman by the roadside called up to the people who were in the lorry, prisoners. At that time it was liberated.
Which country was this?
Germany. And she said, das Hund ist tot. No, das Hund ist kaputt. And I couldn't understand what she was talking. She was telling that Hitler is dead. The Hund, the dog, is kaputt. And that was, that moment I knew that it was over.
Can we go back to Berlin? I mean, how long were you in the factory, the Argus factory?
Argus. Maybe a half a year. Maybe 4 months. Half a year. I know I spent Christmas there. I know that positively.
Can you
and I know
Christmas
it was
there?
Early spring when I left. So before, maybe I went there in September,
October. September 1944. So if we said autumn 1944.
Unfortunately, I'm very bad, and not always bad, but in that case, I'm hopeless about remembering.
You said that you were in the Argus factory at Christmas. What was that like, to be in a camp at that time of year?
I think I mentioned to you, but I don't mind saying it again. It was the most emotional experience I ever had. It was the most... Stop it. It was the most Christmassy. Something was in the air. Sorry, leave it. Please, stop it. It was humanity suddenly shed the nastiness. The German workers brought in the branches of fir trees, and it was silent. It was in the night. I was on a night shift, and which I wanted to tell you before, you know, that what I believe that the German workers were not Nazis is that there was one Nazi amongst them, and they warned us the first minute, be careful, he is a spy. And they hated the man. And this man, in the night, tried to be a good boy. He brought in some food, not to me, to another girl in another machine, from the, and smuggled it in. And he tried to say that I am not a bad boy, you know, but he was a bad boy. But I mean, it was something came over him. He was shed his that evilness which surrounded people and ate his, was eaten their mind. And there were little presents exchanged. And it was very emotional thing. I've been in many Christmases, in many people, and they were very luxurious, but I never had one like that. Never. When you think that is the real meaning of Christmas was there. I knew it. And I never thinking any other way. Sorry. You want to stop? Sorry. I don't.
This is tape 4. I'm conducting an interview with Theresa Gericke. The location is London, England.
Yes, where shall I carry on?
You talked about leaving probably in the winter of 1944-45.
Leaving where? Leaving Berlin.
Yes.
Berlin, yes. Well, on the death march, many people died, you know, from starvation. They couldn't carry on. And but there are a few things which I forgot. And do you mind if I just quickly squeeze it in?
Please do.
And one of them was, you know, when I worked at the Argus factory, that there was that very wonderful German woman, a guard, who collected the prisoners in the middle of the night and in the during the air, it was dark, what you call it when it was?
Air raid?
Not the air raid, when everything dark.
The blackout.
Blackout, during the blackout. And took us to a doctor. We were hanging on to her arm, and she took us to a, probably an Austrian doctor, who looked at my foot, because I have, my foot became septic from that metal thing which went into it. And how I survived, I don't know. It was probably because I was young. Otherwise, standing on it, no penicillin, no nothing, and it was swollen like a balloon. And they were very concerned. So I would like to mention that woman. I have no idea what was her name, but she was a very motherly woman, not only to me, to everybody. And we just hugged her and hang on to her arm, and then she took us in the middle of the night to do that through the between bombing, because the bombing went on and on and on. What I wanted to say before I'm mentioning, you know, that when I was liberated, maybe I'm jumping around in my subject, that the good thing in retrospect, I realized that to be in Berlin was that we know that we were surrounded with liberal-minded Germans. Could have been much worse. But they were, and that was probably some help, which I didn't realize it then, but now I know. And I would be very interested at what other people's opinion was about the ordinary German workers who probably Berliners. I don't can't judge any other from other part, but they were an organized socialist. They were probably organized themselves, but that I don't know. I just guessing. So sorry, I.
You started to talk about the death march, Theresa. But yes. Before that, how were you told that you were going to leave Berlin?
Well, they were, we marched out in a column amongst the houses of Berlin, which were still smoldering, you know, from the air raid, which was maybe happened half an hour before.
What did you see in Berlin as you walked?
Just ruins and ruins and ruins.
And people?
I can't remember people that time. I don't know. Maybe it was just before the Russians stormed it. It was the Russians were not in yet. And that's why the Germans tried to push out all their prisoners, for what reason, I don't know, but thank God they did, to that narrow corridor in Mecklenburg.
How many of
50 million, they said. I don't know, I never counted them, but they said they were 50 million, all prisoners.
How many of
probably
you
my husband was among them. Probably.
Your husband?
He was in prisoner of war.
Where was he a prisoner?
Near Berlin.
But you hadn't met him then?
No. I show you the picture on this book that they were there. I mean, there were millions.
Which army was he with?
I mentioned that. I think we leave that. We don't go into too many things.
So you talked about leaving on this march. How many of you left?
Oh, there were quite a lot. There were quite a lot of people, yeah.
And what did you have with you when you set out?
Somebody from the kitchen where I was friendly gave me a few boiled potatoes, and that was wonderful, taking it as a food. And then on the way, you ate raw potatoes dug out from the soil and scrape it in. By that time I was had dysentery. I was in a poor shape, a very poor shape.
What treatment had you had? Just going back a bit to when you went to see the Austrian doctor. What treatment did
just
he give you?
Just bandaged it. Nothing he could do. Just bandaged it and somehow used done its job. You know. I mean, that's why I got better.
What were you wearing when you set out on the march?
Probably I have still the blue and white thing. Probably. I can't picture myself. I think, you know, I have to point out something to you. I don't think I saw myself in a mirror. There are certain things which it doesn't. I saw the others, but I haven't seen probably myself. The other thing was, which I never done, it was I haven't been sitting on a chair. You sit on the side of things. But I remember my great sensation when I first time I was sitting on a chair. I know these things are odd.
What was the weather like as you set out?
The weather? What was it? I think it was all right, I think.
And who was escorting you?
They changed the SS. They changed it to some other soldiers. And that was psychologically, you maybe understand that if you prisoners and guard usually get used to each other. They almost start to like each other if you're not careful. And when they changed, this went back, I don't know where, the old guard, and the new came, some nasty little young people, we were frightened because they were nasty. One gave me hit my head. I thought my head fly away. So, I mean, that's, you ask me, so I tell you. And they were eventually run away when the Russians came so near. But when I talk about this place where there were probably 15 million prisoners crammed together in a long, long, long corridor. They were not only the various prisoners of the Germans, but they were also the German population was running. So everybody was running in different directions. That's what it was.
So that's what you saw en route.
Mm.
Did you know where you were going?
Not very. Not a little bit. I knew that I'm not going where the Germans go. They told me, they don't know who we were. They said, you must come with us. And I said, they are the Russians there. I said,
and were you still with Elizabeth, your cousin?
Yes, we came back together.
How long were you marching?
It could be 2 weeks, 3 weeks. I don't know.
Did you see people die?
I heard the shot. Yes, I have. I heard left the column and fall by the side, you know, you heard the shot, you don't turn back, you couldn't. You just marched and they probably been shot. Yes, I know a young woman. But that was the biggest chaos imaginable in history.
What pictures do you have in your mind of it?
I have a lovely one, one of them, very nice one. On the way, we were going into a camp where they were, again, foreign workers, probably French, who were playing the violin.
Which camp was this?
On the way, a small, I don't know whether they were on the run or they were already working from there, whether they work in a factory or in a forest. We met some foreign workers, nice young Frenchmen, and they were playing the violin. And I know it was the biggest, it was drained me because, as I said probably before, you know, that nasty thing doesn't make you cry. It's a good thing. When somebody's kind to you, when you hear beautiful music, then you really think you can't take it. It's very difficult to take. And I remember he was playing beautiful classical music in a violin. He offered me to hide me and let the column go on. And I refused it because my cousin wasn't there and I couldn't just disappear. And she goes on. So I went on with her.
What happened then?
Well, eventually, after many barns, we went to several barns. I slept on a manure, a mountain of manure, which was wonderful because it was warm. And I didn't want to go into because they closed the barn door, and I thought that is the nastiest fire hazard imaginable. So I slept outside with a lot of others. And then one day, you know, the German guard just started shaking hands, and we are off.
And where that was were you it. When that happened?
Near Buttenhaven. Must have been near Buttenhaven, not in Buttenhaven, but near. And then we went to a few others, my cousin and a few more others, to off the road and slept in a hay, which was heaven, freedom. And then went back to the main road, and then there slowly there were officials arrived.
Is that when you knew that the war was over?
When I heard that woman saying it, that the Hund ist kaputt. No, and then they told us, you know, where to go, and they said, you know, go to that little village, because that was somehow off the beaten track, that village, Buttenhaven.
You say officials, who were these people?
They were Russians, army.
What did you feel when you heard?
It was chaos. That wasn't, Buttenhaven wasn't occupied yet by anybody. And we slept in a barn with a lot of nationalities. There was the Frenchman with the tricolor around him. and they were Dutch and various nationalities. And the farmer gave a bowl of water, and we washed. Such a thing as modesty did not exist, you know. I mean, you just have a nice wash first time, you know. And she gave us a bowl full of pig trotters. Which was lovely, with the wrong diet for my stomach, because I had a delicate stomach. And then from there, we started our way back to Hungary, which was...
When you say we, who was that?
My cousin. And there was another girl from my hometown, younger girl.
She'd been with you right through?
No, but somehow we met. Came through to Hungary with us. I was told that if somebody, and I found that a big compliment, somebody said, you know, I want to join you because you will find your way home. And I did, but I haven't got a compass. There was no signpost. And I don't think I did one wrong turning. If I drive in London, I would do a lot of wrong turnings, you know, but there somehow.
You talked earlier about a Mongolian Russian soldier who you drew. Can we go back to that time after liberation when you met him?
He collected clothes for me, because I had rags, and he thought that I looked very funny.
Where did he collect the clothes?
From the Germans. He went to the Germans. Collected the clothes, who were petrified. He kept on saying, no, don't be afraid. So that's it.
And you wore these clothes?
I came back in one of them.
Do you remember what he found for you?
Oh, he found all kinds of funny things, you know, but it was a high neck, like a Russian blouse. I don't know where it came from, but it was.
How did he behave towards you as a woman?
I think I told you that story.
I'd like you to tell me.
No, I'm not going to tell you again. He was, I think he was the nicest, one of the nicest men I know. Yes, he was an honorable man. He was. He was a very honorable man. When he left the room after I did the drawing, he just said, only in sign language, none of us spoke Russian. He said, close the door. Because they are Russian, they are drunks in the house, which we did.
Did you see any incidents where
a woman were raped or been nasty? I escaped, I think twice, which was very lucky. Very lucky. There was two young women, two sisters, who didn't escape.
What happened to them?
Next morning, one of them was crying, the other one was saying, stop it. That was it. But why? We wanted to occupy that place and decided, no, we go up to the rain and underneath in the coal cellar, railway carriage, where they carry the coal.
A coal wagon.
Coal wagon, yeah. And they stayed in that little house outside, I don't know. Anyway, it happened where we wanted to go, and lucky that we left, but they found them there, some soldiers. Well, that is war. That's war is nasty in every respect.
You talked about finding your way back to Hungary. What forms of transport were you able to use?
Train, lorry, walking, that's about.
What did you see on your way?
Yeah, when the first one, I want to talk about, you know, the first train, wagon I went up, there were a lot of workers, because they had not only young workers worked in Germany, they were Russians, Ukrainians, who worked on the land. And they were, and I was Mother Russia, a big, big, fat Russian woman who sat there, surrounded with his own people, and she realized that there were three of us were there without any food, and we looked rather pathetic. And she started saying, where is, why you don't eat, you know, and then they throw us some bread. And then I started drawing, because I had paper with me, which was in my very flesh chest that I was, and I put the paper here, which was safe. And then I started drawing her. I did a drawing of an Ukrainian who gave me onions as well as bread. And several, I can't remember, but I know it was more than two, which I did on the on that train. And we felt good, you know, because they were very powerful. The mother was, the woman was a very powerful woman. I still see her, the way she sat there. Peasant woman, peasant, Russian peasant. So they were, you were mixed up with all kind of things.
Which countries did you cross?
I have to, of course, you know, I was become a champion of going up and down trains, you know, where when you had to spend a penny by the side of the train, you know, you had done it in seconds before the train goes. Sorry?
I was wondering which countries you travelled through in order to get home.
I don't know. I think I got home straight. Probably it was Poland. I have no idea. There were no frontiers or proper. I mean, it was, the war was over. When was the war over? Eight or 10th of May.
1945.
Yes, but 8th or 10th.
Well, it depended where you were, I suppose.
Yes, yes. Mm. Yeah. And, I mean, the war, it was still, all the ruins were as you left them. The chaos was awful. The people were, who was something to be afraid, running in this direction. The people who wanted to be at home, running in that direction. One, as I repeat again, my jigsaws fall into that. One day we were going through a battlefield. It looked like a battlefield where the Germans were shooting each other with the Russians, because they were shooting above our heads. I know that. But there was an armchair. Now, can you imagine a comfortable armchair in the middle of the battlefield? And it looks like people fighting, and then they just said, no, let's sit down for a bit, and then they carry on. I mean, but that armchair is stuck in my mind. What probably happened, that people were taking their possessions and they dropped it there because they couldn't carry it any further. That is my picture. But I think, you know, we probably said, I said everything I could. Can I say my final?
Yes, I'd just like to ask you, what did you find when you went back to Hungary, and where did you go first?
I think I told you that, but I don't want to enter that. No, no, I had enough emotion for a day, thank you. No, no, no. All in all, it was a terrible experience. Sometimes I think maybe one should have experience like that, but I don't think one should, not really. But maybe I'm looking at it things differently. It helped me that I'm able to look things different, because of being a painter, you become a bit more observant. You can step out of yourself and looking at it like an onlooker, a viewer. Everybody was a little bit like that. It's not just me, because nobody believed that happened to you. You a little bit, you also look at it from a distance. This can't be me. That can't happen anyway. It can't happen to anybody. So there was in everybody a mixture of being the person who suffered and being the person who actually looked on. And then I, in retrospect, of course, that is easier. But I would like to have just a very short notice to finish my story. Do you mind? And then I think I said almost all, not quite, because I have a book which I have, not a book, a much more detailed one which I'm leaving to my grandchildren. So my parting word to this interview should be, the world is populated with good guys and bad guys. I believe that the only way out of this universal mess is if all decent people on this earth would unite. That is our only choice. I know this sounds very simplistic, but good ideas often are. That's all right.
Thank you, Teresa, for giving us your story. Teresa, can you tell me about this painting?
This painting I probably done in 1944 when I was already very worried, and it shows, I think, on the face, you know, the fear and the worry. And it was underneath a bed for many, many years when somebody fished it out and decided that that's a good portrait.
And how old were you when
you entered it? 29, I think.
And it's a self-portrait?
It is a self-portrait, yes. Yes, I've done it from a mirror. That's why it's expression.
And painted in Szeged?
Yes, 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 I did. Yeah.
Thank you.
I not always like to look at it, but some people like it. But that's why it was under the bed for such a long time, because each time I look at it, it threatens me.
Threatens you?
Yeah, my eyes threaten me. Yeah. Yes, but I think it was a good portrait. But
what do you think your expression is saying?
I'm afraid, or that's all, fear in the eyes, I think. Yeah. No, I can't say more to
it. Do you remember what you thought while you painted it?
No, you can't remember all these things which goes on in your life, no. I can't, no. But, very reluctantly that I let it have it photographed, because that's it.
Thank you.
Okay.
Can you tell me about this cross?
I found this cross in the dust amongst all kind of other belongings which prisoners was taken off or dropped. And that was probably in Auschwitz. And that was probably a Polish prisoner who dropped it or being taken off. Whether she went to the gas chamber or what happened to her, we don't know, but I treasured it ever since. And I thought that my story, looking at it in a symbolic way, I went in with a bottle of cyanide. And that's how I came out. That was the day when I was taken to, left Auschwitz.
What feelings does it evoke?
It is carved from, I just want to say many people to guess what is it made of. It was carved by hand in the prison, probably, from a domino or something which is black and white. It could be some. They don't call it plastic in those days, something else. I think it's like from a domino. And there is a number on it, but I don't know it has any bearing, you know, that it was of its origin. It is probably because it was already on that piece of material which they carved it out. I don't know.
What is the number?
I don't know by heart.
455. Would that be right?
Yeah. Yes, that could be. Yes. Yeah. You looked at it?
Yes.
Yeah, 455. Mm-hmm. It has no significance, but...
What does it mean to you?
It means a lot to me. It means a lot to me. I was carrying it with me for a long time, and I suddenly started worrying it that, you know, I carry it in my purse, you know, I drop it or somebody steal my purse, so I put it in my neck, and that's where it is, and that's where it belongs.
Thank you.